Today we're going to talk about vision loss and take a very stepwise approach to most diseases, and vision loss is going to be no exception. So we're going to go through in a stepwise fashion to try to decide how and why certain animals lose their vision. So when I'm presented with an animal that has lost their vision, the most important thing I start with is a very thorough history, because the history can sometimes tell you what's going on before you even examine the animal. So it's a good tool to guide you in the right direction. So some questions to ask the owner about the vision loss include, was the vision acutely lost or has it been slowly progressive? Has there been night vision loss, day vision loss, or has there been complete vision loss? Just one eye or both eyes? Next, have the owners noticed any changes to the eyes? Has the dog or cat been squinting? Have the eyes been very red? Has there been a lot of cloudiness or any other changes noticed by them? I also like to ask about systemic changes, you know, or any behavioral changes, including changes in mentation. And some of those can just be due to the change in vision. A lot of blind animals are disoriented in the beginning, but also that could also be associated with other disease in the body. I also ask about changes in urination and appetite, you know, drinking behavior, because those also can signify certain systemic diseases that can manifest themselves in the eye. Well, unfortunately, animals don't walk into our clinics with signs telling us what's wrong with them. And so always it's up to us to try to decide what's going on. And to try to determine if a dog is or cat is visual or not can be difficult. And so there's some things we can do to try to decide how much vision is present or are they completely non-visual. So one thing I like to do is set up a maze test, and that sounds very complex, but it's actually very easy. What we do is we take the dog into our hallway, pull out a bunch of chairs and garbage cans, and have the animal navigate through that maze. We do that with the lights on, and then we turn the lights off and look to see if there's a difference in between the two. We also look at their tracking response, ability to follow a flying object, if you will. And I like to use a cotton ball, and I just throw it through their field of vision, and they should go ahead and follow that cotton ball to the ground. Now, I prefer a cotton ball to a treat or a ball or anything like that, because those can actually make noise when they hit the ground, so you may be testing their auditory function and not their vision. And things that, like treats, also have a smell, and some animals have such a keen sense of smell that they'll actually follow the treat with their nose. So I prefer a cotton ball, to other types of objects. Well, then on a very crude sense, we can do things like a menace response, where we bring our hands up towards the eye in a menacing gesture, and the animal, of course, should blink. That's a very crude test of vision, but is a test to say, hey, do we see at least a little bit of motion? And then lastly, a dazzle reflex, where we take a very bright light and shine it in the eye, and the animal should respond by either turning the head away or closing the eye. And that's probably the crudest of all vision tests, because it just looks at light perception present or not. So once we've decided that an animal has reduced or absent vision, the next thing we have to ask ourselves is, where's the problem? And so localizing the site of vision loss is going to be our number one task. And so this is a schematic of an eye that I drew. And so when I look at, where's the problem, I divide into three places. So the first is the anterior segment, meaning is there a problem with the cornea or is there a problem with the lens? The second place I look at is the posterior segment, specifically the retina. And then the last section we look at is beyond the eye, meaning the retrobulbar optic nerve or the brain. So what happens in these cases that you look at the dog or the cat, specifically dog in this case, where the eye actually looks 100% normal, you can't find any abnormalities, but vision's not present in either eye. Well, then we have to decide, could it be a primary retinal disease, or could this be brain disease? So we want to rule out something such as SARDS, or sudden acquired retinal degeneration syndrome, versus central or brain disease. The diagnostic test of choice to distinguish between SARDS and a brain disease is going to be the electroretinogram. An electroretinogram is a test in which we look at the summed electrical potential of the retina. And this is done by putting a contact lens electrode on the cornea, a recording electrode next to the eye at the lateral canthus, and then the ground at the occipital cortex. A series of bright lights are then shined at the eye, and every time that light shines and the retina fires, we capture that response and we get it waveform. So this is what a normal electroretinogram in a dog looks like. What we like to measure is outlined by the red circle here. That's called the B wave. And the B wave in a normal dog is usually over about 100 microvolts. In this dog, it's 340, so a very normal electroretinogram. Well, if you have a dog that has a normal appearing eye and a normal electroretinogram that does not have vision, these are cases where we have brain disease, because the eye itself is working normally, but something posterior to the eye is not. Alternatively, if you perform an electroretinogram and you get this type of pattern, a flatline waveform, this says that there's no retinal electrical activity, at least not measurable electrical activity. So in cases like this, this is consistent with SARDS. Brain causes of vision loss can be things such as retrobulbar optic neuritis. There can be disease anywhere along the optic tract as well as within the brain. And that can be diffuse disease. There can also be focal mass, as we see in the MRI here at the optic chiasm or within the visual cortex. When I see a normal electroretinogram in these dogs without any changes in the eye, my knee-jerk reaction is to go ahead and refer them to a neurologist. So in summary, vision loss in dogs and cats can be difficult to diagnose, and the first step is to localize where the vision loss is occurring. But unfortunately, even if you identify the lesion, the prognosis for the return of vision still remains relatively poor.